have it abundantly. He will lead you in the paths of righteousness. That's the mastery of the shepherd.
For more about Love Worth Finding and Adrian Rogers, visit our website at lwf.org.
The following program contains views and opinions which are not necessarily those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.
Hello, everybody!
Coming up on today's experience, it's Dr. Dave's Devotional Diamonds of the Day, also known as DDDDDs, where my daily devotions become some of our spiritual reflections. Sound effects placed throughout the show which have nothing to do with life, but the Bible teaches there's a time to laugh, and there's quite a few of you that could use a good laugh. The review of the Goofy News, which proves Jesus, is coming back sooner than you think. Take a look around. I think that's pretty clear. Life lessons for our faith that we can actually use probably won't if we sit on our blessed assurance. Humor that will force you to think, why does this guy have a radio show? Because my wife says on a regular basis, you have a face for radio. Also, Bible trivia for fake and yet somehow real cool prizes, your phone calls, and more. The David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. My name is Dr. David Spoon, and I'll be your host for the next 5,400,000 milliseconds. Get ready for one of the more bizarre experiences on live radio. Here's the key to the show. We don't know what we're doing. We have no idea what's going to happen, and we don't care. But for the next few minutes, I want to talk faith with you. So here we go. We're asking questions about living life as a Christian, that thingy right there. And what do we ask on Thursdays? Every single Thursday, we do not hold it back. We have no reservation. We do not care because the question that we ask you challenges you and me exactly how we're engaging with God. Are we expecting more in 2024? That's the question. You're like, but Dave, it's September. Congratulations. I'm glad you know the month. Here's the bottom line. The bottom line is, are you expecting more from God? Is your level of faith an expectant one, or are you expecting a poke in the eye with a sharp stick? What are you looking for? What are you anticipating from the Lord? I mean, today, tomorrow, and every day for the rest of this year. Are you expecting more in 2024? It's very simple. If you have an opinion, a comment, a thought, or a question, please don't let it die of loneliness. We do consider that to be sad. We want you to reach out and give us a call. You call 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, well, by golly, you'll end up talking to Jammin' Jacob. Kind of feels like it's September around here. Hey, if you end up talking to our very own Jammin' Jacob, that's like spending time relaxing and chillaxing. Hey, 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 ho, hey, ho, ho.
Thank you, David. Happy Thursday.
Happy Thursday to you, my friend. You having a good day? Everything going well?
So far, so good. Having a great day. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. No poke in the eye with a sharp stick thus far. Expecting
more. That's
always
good.
I know. It's just a great thing, right? Expecting more for 2024 from the Lord. Absolutely, absolutely. Now, look, if you want to reach out to us by phone, we just told you how to do that. But you can also text us. Text us. Not Texas. Text us. 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. A little slower now for those that need it that way.
214-210-8483. Wow.
There you go. Additionally, you can send an email, David at hemustincrease.org, D-A-V-I-D, that's my name, David, at, A with a circle around it, he must increase, from John 3:30, he must increase, I must decrease, .org, because we're a nonprofit entity, that's right. So why would you call us, why would you text us, or why would you email us? Let me explain that and make it simple. First and foremost, maybe you have a praise report, and you're thinking, I know, Dave, but I'm afraid to call on the radio. Don't be afraid, just share it. Let the Lord take care of what people hear. Let the Lord take care of what takes place between what you're sharing about what God did and what he does with it. That's all in his hands. You don't have to say anything brilliantly. You just be willing to be the vessel. If you share that praise report, it'll strengthen it in your own life, which is very important. It will bless other people, which is exceedingly important. And then it will glorify God, and that is the most important thing. So when you share a praise report, those things take place. Maybe you've got a prayer request. You got something going on. It's like, I need prayer. Like, let's do it. Let's bring it. I don't care what your background is. We have one heavenly Father, our Father who art thou in heaven. Jesus said our, right? Number two, we are blood relatives through the blood of Jesus Christ. Number three, we drink of the same Holy Spirit. If you're Baptist, Church of Christ, Church of God, Presbyterian, Methodist, I don't care. If you love Jesus, even if you don't love Jesus, call and we'll pray for you so you will love Jesus. But if you've got a prayer request, prayer changes the universe. The universe in your realm, the universe in people around you, and the universe everywhere else. We already know it stops time. Just read a little bit of Joshua chapter 10 to pick that up. And so the bottom line is prayer requests are phenomenal because we get to engage with God and strengthen one another. Additionally, maybe you've got a scripture or something the Lord's put on your heart. Totally cool. We're not anti-politics. I don't want really people to get that idea. I tell people on a regular basis, you should make whatever decision you're going to make in voting based on your connection with God and his word. It's not very complex. God makes out, kind of lays things out on the line for you. And if you can figure that out, but we're geared more towards encouraging one another because we just feel like everybody needs more encouragement. That's how it is. And when we encourage one another, we ourselves are encouraged, and that's a good thing. So you can call, you can text, you can email. I'm going to open up with a word of prayer and then a couple of announcements, and then we will get into the book of Revelation. Wow. Okay, that's exciting. But let's open up with a word of prayer. Just hang with me. I think you'll appreciate where I'm heading with this. Just stretch your faith through the radio airwaves or internet airwaves or internet, you know, terrestrial and satellite kind of thing, whatever it is. Just stretch your faith with mine. Here we go. Father, we come before you right now, and first and foremost, Lord, you are more than worthy. You are more than gracious to us. You are more than kind to us, and not one of us deserves your goodness. And your goodness exceeds every single one of us. So, Lord, I want to pray for this audience right now, this specific thing, Lord. Everybody's holding something, dealing with something, struggling with something, or working on something. Lord, that we would have the foresight and the wisdom to follow your word, and first and foremost, above all things, surrender it into your hands. Instead of trying to carry it, instead of trying to manipulate it, instead of trying to mold it, that we would surrender it and be still before you, understanding that you are Lord, you are God. And instead of complaining about it or getting frustrated about it, Lord, help us to lift up our voices with a sacrifice of praise, our lips giving thanks to you on a regular basis for everything. You teach us in your word, 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Help us to do your will. Help us to surrender the things that are heavy. Things that we're able to walk with, let us walk with in a perfect partnership with you. Things that shouldn't matter, let them not matter. Let us not be anxious for anything, but in everything, giving thanks, lifting our petitions to you. Help us to walk the walk right. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Okay, a couple of quickie announcements. Number one, we are going to be talking to, I think it's JD and Nancy are putting together kind of a social event. We're looking about October 8th, 9th, 10th, in that range, somewhere in there. We're looking at getting a little place that we can all meet. It would be our first actual meeting. And so if you have not heard about this before, I did mention it once or twice before. There will be some updates, I'm sure, forthcoming, and we'll let you know what that is. We do not really know how to anticipate how many people may or may not show up, so we might do a reservation kind of process. That seems like probably a pretty good idea. And we'll do our best just to make it accommodating. It's not going to be a church service or anything. It's going to be a fellowship gathering. That's what we're going to do. We're going to get together in fellowship. We'll just see how it breaks down, what comes up, and I think it'll be really cool. So I'm just telling you ahead of time that that is something that we are looking to do in the first 10 or 12 days of October. So just be aware of that, number one. Okay, that's number one. Number two, I do have a guest in my studio today. This guest will not say very much, but it is the first time my guest has been here in at least 2 years, if not 3 years, maybe even 4 years. And so I just want everybody to say a brief hello. You can say it back to her, but she'll say first to you hello. Yeah, grab that mic. This is my wonderful best friend, best person I know on the planet Earth, my very own Noelle, who is with me today as we're hanging out together. Say hi, honey bunny.
Hi, honey bunny.
Okay, that's funny, honey.
He's making me do this.
That's right. I am making her do this. She said hi. For those that do not know, that's my wife. She's hanging out with me today. We were working on some of her flower business stuff today, so we ended up spending the day together and decided to come down and hang out with us. So just letting you know she's hanging out here. Isn't that cool? It's cool for me anyway. Now she's pushing the mic away and making faces and so on and so forth. All right, in the meantime, we're going to get into the Word of God. And so what we are going to do is turn your mic away. Let's just take her mic off because there's a little echo there. Right? Are we there? Thank you. Okay. Now somebody is calling in. And because they're calling in, we always take those calls first because it's how we roll. So what will we do? So if somebody is calling in, I'll give Jacob a chance to, let me turn that up. Let's see. Can you hear now? You can't hear now? Oh, he turned the whole thing off. Oh, okay. All right. So anyway, let's see what's going on the telly, and then we're going to get into the book of Revelation, and I promise you, this is going to be some pretty cool stuff. Now, again, if you have a prayer request or something that you need help with, we want to be able to help you. That's kind of how we function. So let me check with Jacob and see what's going on real quickly. What do we got going on? Is somebody just calling in to say hi, or what do we got?
We have a prayer request.
Okay, let's bring that through. On Noelle's thing, could you make sure that her headset still works, even if her mic is off? I don't know if you can do that or not. I don't know if we can do that or not, so you'll see if it works. So he'll work on that. Okay, let's have that person call through. If they've got a prayer request, let's bring them on through. Knock, knock. This is David. Who am I talking to?
Hey, good afternoon, David. This is Curtis, my friend. How are you doing?
I'm doing all right, Curtis. How are you doing?
Man, I'm pretty good, brother. You'll have to excuse the background noise. I'm rolling down Stemmons right now. David, my sweet dear friend Robin, I believe I've called before, who was she's struggling with the whole tapering process. She's still kind of in the middle of all that, and then lately, man, she's just been, her spirits are so very low, and apparently this whole scenario was quite the roller coaster ride, David, and I just wondered if we could lift her up to God and maybe so he could put his healing hands on her like only he can. But she's really, really struggling with it right now, and I'm so very concerned about her.
All right, Curtis, let's pray for her right now. Let's pray for Robin. Let's do it. Let's take our faith and bring it before the Lord and watch something happen. Okay, let's do it. Father, we come before you right now, and first of all, I thank you for Curtis. Keep him safe on the road. He's driving, Lord. He's got to keep his focus on that, and we want him to. But, Lord, he's brought petition for Robin, and Robin is going through it, Lord. She's going through the up and down, kind of the yo-yo roller coaster part, and emotionally, psychologically, and physically. And, Lord, we need the healing power of the Most High God. We need the Lord of hosts to come and touch her body by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need, in the name of Jesus, touch for Robin so that Robin can know that you are with her, walking with her, hand in hand, supporting her. You're there for her. And Lord, just help her to even out so that she doesn't have such a up and down, up and down, up and down. Help her to even out. Let it be very consistent for her, and let that consistency be your grace and mercy and the peace that passes all understanding. Let that be upon her and physically touch her body by the miraculous power that comes from heaven. Lord, you tell us when we pray, our Father who art thou in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let your will be done in Robin's life on earth as your will is done in heaven, and bring healing for her and touch her and encourage her, and bless Curtis for caring enough to petition on her behalf. That's an awesome brother. And we just really, really appreciate that and ask you to bless these two in this situation in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, David. Thank you so much.
You are welcome, my brother. You keep me posted. You either text me or otherwise, and at least I'll keep knowing how to keep praying for you, and we'll keep praying for you anytime, okay?
Thank you, David. Have a blessed day, my friend.
All right. God bless you, brother. Be safe.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye. All right. Let's get into it. We're going to get into the revelation right now. This is our time, people. This is what we do. Here we are. We're in Revelation chapter 1. We won't get through the whole thing today. I think you guys can pretty much figure that out. We're going to pick it up in Revelation chapter 1, verse 9. It says this: John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. This is coming from John. The first thing I want to tell you is Patmos, so you can understand what was really going on, because everybody talks about Patmos like they know. The island of Patmos was about 10 miles long and about 6 miles wide. Okay, got that? About 10 miles long, 6 miles wide. It was roughly about 50 to 60 miles south of Ephesus. The prisoners there were forced to work in granite quarries as part of their punishment on the island. So we're not sure to what extent John was involved in that physical punishment, because he was much older. But we are acutely aware that this island was used to isolate people in society who society no longer wanted to hear from. And that's why he was on the island of Patmos, to be removed and forgotten. After you look through the book of Revelation, you figure, well, that failed spectacularly, because many millions and millions and millions of people heard from John when he was on the island of Patmos. It just shows you that God does what God wants to do. But let's back it up to verse 9, where he says this: I, John, both your brother and your companion. It is almost, I didn't say it is beyond belief, I just said it's almost beyond belief that John, at the beginning of this letter, is identifying himself as a brother and as a companion, and not as somebody who is a, let's say, superior Christian apostle. This is the guy that's lived the longest after the entire thing. He was there for all the miracles. He wrote the gospel. He wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. He's writing this book in Revelation. There is nobody more seasoned, nobody more powerful, nobody more influential. When this guy speaks, everybody listens. He would make E.F. Hutton seem like a mime, because this guy had the chops. When he spoke, wowzer bowser, very powerful. Look what he says. He says, I am your brother and I am your companion. The most spiritual, phenomenal people that I know would never say to you they're spiritual or phenomenal. The true leaders are some of the most humble people, I'll just tell you an experience I had, and I'm just using this as an example, okay? So when I had a chance to meet Robert Jeffress in person when we were in San Diego, you know, he's very powerful on television, does a great job, he's a phenomenal pastor, but when him and I talked, it was just like I was talking to my buddy having coffee. That's what I'm talking about, though. And whether you think that's great or not, I'm telling you, when somebody's in a power influential position and they have the capacity to be just that genuine, that's exactly what John does right here. Think about that. I'm your brother. I'm your companion. Don't you love that? I love it. How great is that? This powerful, unbelievable, influential person in the kingdom of God is like, hey, I'm just your brother. I'm just your companion. We're just doing this together. And then he says this, and you're not going to miss this because I'm not going to let you miss this. He says this. He says, I'm both your brother and your companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ. There's no way we're going to get through this in a year. First and foremost, he says this. I am your companion and your brother and your companion in tribulation. Notice he doesn't say, you know, and I'm looking for a fast exit. He's like, I am your companion in tribulation. The book of Acts makes it absolutely clear that through many tribulations, one must enter the kingdom of God. Have you been through tribulations? Well, then you're on a good track, aren't you? And John's like, hey, I'm your brother in that. I get that. I mean, he's writing from an island where they've ostracized him, whether he's having to do physical labor or not. I cannot even answer. But the idea behind that is that he's like in this terrible place, in this terrible thing, going through terrible tribulation himself. And he's like, I share that with you. There's no, you don't escape that. And even when Peter was writing, he said, don't be surprised by the fiery trials. Why? Because you belong to Jesus and the world hates Jesus. So why is that a shock to you? The enemy is still being allowed to run. He doesn't even have the full authority, but he has been loosed for a little time, so to speak. And he's all that he's doing is still has a restriction. He still has to ask permission, right, for to touch Job, to touch Peter. He has to ask permission. The only problem that people don't recognize is each time he asked permission, God said yes. But that's not the issue. The issue is simply this. The enemy's against you 24/7. He hates you. You love Jesus. He hates Jesus. You love God. He hates God. Don't you understand? You're an enemy. So there's tribulation. That's part of it. Is it every single moment of every day? Of course not. But it's there. There's not a demon behind every rock, but there are some demons behind some rocks. And we need to be aware of that, right? So he's like, I'm your brother. I'm your companion in tribulation. And then he goes, in the kingdom. Now, here's where it gets cool, because he's like, okay, tribulation. Well, okay, we have to go through it. That's part of it. But he says, in kingdom. So I'm your brother and companion in the kingdom. What do you mean in the kingdom? That has to do with everything that's connected to God's work. Father, who art thou in heaven? I already said, thy kingdom come, thy will, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it's done in heaven. That's kingdom. Right there. There it is. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What's the kingdom? That. The kingdom of God is where God is king. And so how powerful is it? Like, okay, so yeah, we got this together. We're in this, you know, we're in this situation here. Tribulations, yep, got to hang out together. But keep in mind, it's also for kingdom. And the kingdom is everything to do with God's work, being engaged with God's work and doing the things that glorify and honor God. And then he says the last one, and this is the one that I actually hate more than tribulation. That's right, I said it. Because he says this, I, John, both your brother and companion in tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ. Uh-oh. But Dave, you're a doctor. Yeah, I don't have any patience. Here's the bottom line. The bottom line is this is what most of us lack. Understanding that everything operates according to God's perfect timing. Yes, but you're telling me he couldn't, like, do it faster? Not if it's going to be perfect timing. Well, I know, but I want it faster. Well, congratulations on what you want. I hope you get Rice Krispies with that. That doesn't matter. What matters is that we operate in the understanding that God does everything perfectly. He's not lame or sideways as God. He's perfect in that. And so we need to have this connection and in the patience of Jesus Christ. And look at, if you think about this, if I break this down in the Greek, besides talking about the reality that people try to operate outside of God's timing. Even Abraham did that. The reality is just also consider how patient Jesus was when his own creation was spitting on him. Wow. Just, whoa. Right. I, John, both your brethren commanded in tribulation and kingdom impatience of Jesus Christ was on the island called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Let me just make sure you understand this before we go any further. It was for the word of God because he would not be ashamed of the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ because he would not be ashamed of the gospel. If you were in that prison because you were a schmo, that's different. If people are mean to you or treat you poorly because you're just a kind of a rotten person, that's entirely different. If you're being a jerk that one day and people respond to that, that's not you being a Christian being persecuted. That's you being a jerk and people responding to it. Isn't that different?
Yeah.
This is about the Christian element of persecution. This is about things that are taking place because you are connected to Jesus. Don't you know they mock you? You do know that. They mock you, not even because they know you. They mock you because you belong to Jesus. And Jesus said, if they did this to the master of the house, what are they going to do to the children? Right? That's us. So in this, I know it's only one verse, and I know it's 20 minutes, but that doesn't matter. I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation, got it, and in the kingdom, got it, and in the patience of Jesus Christ, wow, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. If you're going to be persecuted, if you're going to be challenged, if you're going to be tried, if you're going to be attacked, then let it be for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ and not you and I being just lousy people. That's just common sense. There's nothing even revelatory in any of that. It's just like, yeah, that's pretty practical. Yeah, because we haven't gotten to the weirdo stuff yet. We're on our way. We're just not there yet, okay? All right, we are going to stop right there. Take a deep breath. Take a break, as we do at this time all the time. You're right now listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Since the dawn of the internet, people have been looking for a website they can be proud of without costing an arm or a leg. People want a quality website to promote their ministry, business, hobby, or passion. Introducing Cowpunch Sites. Cowpunch Sites can help you create and maintain a quality website. From design to security, Cowpunch does it all. Cowpunch is a family-owned and operated business, taking a fresh approach to business. Lots of clients at lower prices. Make mom happy.
The most significant benefit of working with Cowpunch Sites is that you work with real people, not cheesy templates. No outsourcing. It's $57 a month, and there's no setup fee and no cancellation fees. When you go to cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's me. Oh, did I mention that it's $57 a month? Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no bull.
Dave, this is a nice radio station.
Oops, sorry. That's Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no baloney. There, that's better. Cowpunchsites.com/dad. The deterioration of the ecosystem, or creation itself, is definitely the result of man.
You say, well, how can you say that? Well, Romans chapter 8, verse 19 through 21. I just read the scriptures. I don't need anything else. The Bible says this: the creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. Creation itself is longing for the redemption that comes through Jesus Christ. And until that takes place, it is on a collision course down. The result of the ecosystem or creation itself crashing is a result of man's sin in the garden. So when they say, oh, well, it's not man-made, oh, yes, it is. Of course it's man-made. It's because we messed up in the garden. But I wasn't with Adam and Eve. You were in the person of Adam and Eve. And if you want me to use it, you were in the life-giving force of Adam and Eve. And if you want me to really say it, you were in the loins of Adam and Eve. You were there, too. They stuck their fist up to God and said, nope. And God went, okie dokie, here's the result.
The David Spoon Experience.